The way I always learned best was through experience. So I want to share some of my experience with you, couched in cliche, and hopefully there will be something here that inspires you. First, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. I grew up in a housing project in Lawrence, Massachusetts, the 26th poorest city in the country. I'm the fourth child and the youngest in my family. Our father left us when I was born. We were on welfare, we didn't have new clothes, and oftentimes we didn't have food. Our mother drove cab and worked as a waitress to try to make ends meet. Most of the time, we were unsupervised. The projects that we lived in had about 400 units, and pretty much every unit had at least one kid in it, and most had more than one. So we lived with about 400 or 500 kids in a really small area. It was like a huge playground, where at any moment you could get together a football or baseball game or play hide and go seek or tag. But most of us were also figuring out just how to survive in what could be a pretty tough world. I like to say that that time in my life was part Stand By Me, part Lord of the Flies. Right across the street from the projects was a state swimming pool that was a municipal pool, but the kids in the projects felt like it was our pool. We spent every day of the summer there. It was our vacation. A few weeks before fifth grade was going to start, I went to the pool to hang out with a boy I had had a crush on all summer. His name was Andy Puglisi. I left the pool that day to go home and get something to eat, and I thought it was like any other day, until the middle of the night when the police were banging on our door and our mother was pulling us out of our bed. The police were there asking my brothers and I if we had seen Andy, and when was the last time we were with him. The next morning, the projects had changed completely. There were Army helicopters flying overhead, the National Guard were marching through the projects, and people everywhere were calling Andy's name. But he was gone. He was never seen again. Andy was about to turn 10, and I was 9. One of the things I remember most about that time was the look on the adults' faces after Andy vanished. Most of these adults were seasoned survivors, bikers, single mothers, grandparents raising their grandchildren. But they had a look on their face that I'll never forget. They were afraid. And I was bewildered. I couldn't grasp where Andy was. I didn't understand why the adults couldn't find him. And when the search was called off after 6 days, I remember standing outside Andy's apartment thinking, someday, when I grow up, I'm going to try to find him. Not long after Andy disappeared, we moved out of the projects. My mother was slowly slipping away into her own world, and us kids were left pretty much on our own. By the time I was 12, my brother and I were kicked out of eighth grade and held back. I went to summer school so that I could get into high school and be with my friends. I didn't know then that a few months into high school, I would end up leaving my home, becoming a ward of the state, and eventually living with my mother's sister and her husband, a loving and intelligent couple who nurtured me back to health and in whose care I went from being a malnourished eighth grade dropout to becoming a well-adjusted National Honor Society typical high school kid. I had more than a fair share of experience before my time, but what didn't kill me made me stronger and more compassionate. I wish for you that the difficult times in your life will bring out the richness in your character, that they will teach you hope and strength and compassion, and that you will believe in yourself. My next cliche, and I'm going to take another drink of water, excuse me. Believe in yourself. You know, Fitchburg State wasn't actually my first choice. In 1984, I graduated from Air High School, and I was accepted by New Hampshire College. My guardian was a professor there, so I got reduced tuition and free room and board. I had no clue what to expect in college. And I remember the day I left home, I left with nothing more than an overnight bag and a can of tuna fish. During the first semester of my freshman year, we had to take an English proficiency exam. It was a pass-fail exam with the entire semester's grade contingent upon the one test. Many of the students there were worried about failing. I was in an honors English class with a 4.0 average. I remember reassuring the girls on my dorm floor. I even began tutoring them to help them get through the test. It wasn't until I was home during winter break when my grades came that I discovered I was the only one on our floor who had failed the test. It was supposed to be an objective essay on a provocative topic, but I expressed my opinion and I failed. It was a hard lesson to learn. The following semester, my aunt, the woman who loved me back to life, was seriously ill. I transferred to Fitchburg State to be closer to home so I could help take care of her. She died in April of my freshman year. She was 36, and I was 18. I came to Fitchburg as a sophomore and a commuter. I didn't know anyone. My classmates had already had a full year to get to know each other. I enrolled in human services classes and began learning more than I ever had ever thought I could know about the human spirit. Classes like psychology of captivity and interviewing techniques would later lend themselves to my ultimate career choice in a way I could never have predicted. I completed practicum in local agencies like Luck and Digital Equipment, and I learned by doing. I met some of the hardest working and toughest professors in my life. And in addition to the knowledge that comes from books, I learned to believe in myself. I kept a 3.5 or higher GPA while I worked as a waitress at a place called Tweed's. I moved into an off-campus apartment and I paid my own tuition and rent. In my last semester of comm media, I wanted to do my internship at WGBH, one of the best documentary film broadcasters in the country. But someone told me I would never get in, that they only accepted Ivy League interns and that I shouldn't even try. Thankfully, I didn't listen, and I believed in myself. Not only did I get the internship with WGBH, but I was the only intern who was hired at the end of the year. Of the dozen or so students who were interns with the state the student with the state college education was the only one who had had enough practical experience and enough work ethic actually making student films to know about story structure and research and what time code is and how a vectorscope worked. But probably more than anything else, because of what I had taught here, I believed I could do the job and do it well, and I did. I was hired to work on a film about wild dolphins. The first shoot I went on was in Sarasota, Florida, on a boat where we filmed marine scientists capturing, testing, and releasing bottlenose dolphins. Here I was in a boat off the coast of Florida, swimming with dolphins and getting paid for it. I knew then I had chosen the right career and the right college. Years later, I would make my own film, and I knew it would have to be something I cared so deeply for that I would do it no matter what. It would be something that was inside of me that I would have to pull out and make sense of. I decided to make a film about Andy. At first, I was told I shouldn't, and then I was told I couldn't. I wrote grant applications and was rejected. Sometimes the rejections were harder than I expected. Turns out I would be able to wallpaper half my office with rejection letters. I worked on the film for over 5 years without a broadcaster, but with the help and encouragement of so many amazing people, from Andy's family to my family, to our editor and composer, we forged ahead. And in June of 2007, the film, Have You Seen Andy? The Personal Story of My Search for Answers to the Disappearance of My Childhood Friend, aired on HBO. The following year, it won an Emmy for Best Investigative Journalism. It was an incredible experience to have survived Andy's disappearance and nearly two decades later be standing in Lincoln Center in New York City accepting an Emmy on his behalf. I know today that I couldn't have made that film if I didn't at first believe that I could. Try to remember, as Michael Jordan famously said, you have to expect things of yourself before you can do them.